You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to the Sociology of Work. My name is Sergio Soto, and today's discussion will focus around employment, life on the job, and a number of other things. But before we get into that, right, you know, we'll talk a little bit about this program and what's it a part of, right? So this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. So this spring, we will be broadcasting four classes: Political Science 310, Current Issues in American Government, on Tuesday from 7 to 9 p.m. Social and Behavioral Sciences 318, Cultural Pluralism, on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. Political Science 335, International Politics, on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And Communication 300, Organizational Communication, on Sunday from noon to 2 p.m. So if you'd like more information about this program, the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, please visit our website at appliedstudies.tv, or you can call 1-866-278-6789. So right there you have the plan for next year, right? Many of you who are taking this class are part of that program, and you know, you definitely have some exciting things on the horizon. But anyhow, you know, today's discussion is going to really revolve around employment and unemployment. So for most of us, you know, being employed is not a, you know, or, you know, being employed is a necessity. Working is a necessity. Exchanging our labor for money is a necessity, you know, because we need to buy the things that we consume. We need to pay for housing and things like that. So for the most part, it's not an option, right? Unless you're, you know, old enough to retire or have the economic means to not have to worry about that, or you're young and you're kind of locked out of the workforce, you know. But anyhow, you know, gainful employment, you know, is, you know, linked to financial pressure. You know, we often kind of think about job satisfaction being linked not only to the prestige, the status associated with work — this is something that we've discussed over the last 2 weeks — but also the amount of money that we make, right? You know, basically, the income that is generated gives us, to a certain extent, some independence, some economic independence. So when we think about unemployment, you know, we can, you know, it's pretty clear to see why it's problematic, right? It's problematic because, you know, it can force someone into poverty, or can, you know, create a situation where the poverty is persistent. So, you know, just to kind of, you know, throw this out there, right? So when we think about equality and, you know, trying to strive for it, you know, the greatest inroads towards equality have been made. You know, it hasn't been perfectly equal, but have been made when unemployment is low. And when low, you know, when there's a low unemployment, you know, it all, you know, it also kind of stimulates the economy. But, you know, just remember, you know, since labor is an economy, there's always, you know, I mean, labor's a commodity. You know, the labor market exists. It can never truly be, you know, at 0%, right? You know, to a certain extent, that might make certain kinds of labor unaffordable. But lately, because of our economic downturn, we've been paying a lot of attention to unemployment rates, right? This was one of the big issues during the, you know, past, you know, presidential campaign, right? You know, who's going to push unemployment down, you know? And, it's something that for some of us, you know, it is a very real experience, right? Since we need jobs, right? We need to be able to, you know, have a stream of income. Most of us rely on employment, on jobs. So, having to compete a whole lot more, or not having an opportunity to access employment inside a job market, you know, is problematic. So what we want to do first is kind of consider what the impact of the unemployment rate is on young people. So what we're going to do next is, before we get into discussion of how or what the unemployment rate is, how it works, how it's constructed, we're going to kind of take a look at a short video. It's about three minutes long, where we're going to kind of be introduced to some of these ideas about, you know, what it is to be young and facing this high unemployment rate that on a national average is problematic. So let's take a look at that now, and then we'll be right back.
And you can see there this morning the jobs report, monthly jobs report came in. 171,000 jobs created in October. That was better than expectations. That kind of caps off really three decent months for jobs growth. Unemployment rate ticked up to 7.9%. Not a very good number, but of course better than where we were a year ago, 2 years ago, all that. However, this morning on the Markets Hub, what we're going to focus on is the picture for youth employment, especially given Tuesday's big election. What are the youth of this country looking at? We have Paul Conway with us, who used to be chief of staff at the Department of Labor. Now he runs Generation Opportunity. Paul, I want to thank you for the opportunity for us to spend a few minutes this morning. What did you make of these numbers this morning, especially as it pertains to, you know, kids out of college, kids in high school, to the youth vote there?
Sure. Well, I think it's important to first take a look at the numbers. And so at 171,000 jobs, really what you need are 150,000 jobs at a minimum per month just to absorb new workers into the American workforce. So 171,000 jobs is a mixed bag. 7.9% is not an unemployment level that anybody would celebrate in their right mind. For young Americans, here's what the issue is. Today, the unemployment number is 12%. For young Americans. There are an additional 1.7 million young Americans who are not counted in the number. And if you were to take that number, the labor force participation rate, and factor it into the 12%, you'd actually have today an unemployment level for young Americans of 16.5%. And that is the thing that will create a political reality for those who are going to vote next Tuesday, because in their lives, they don't actually see the change that has been promised.
Yeah, you know, I don't know if you can see right now, we're pulling up some of the numbers you gave us on youth unemployment, breaking it down by some of the various demographics. You guys calculated these numbers. These are non-seasonally adjusted numbers, right? This 12% for unemployment rate?
Yeah, that's correct. That's all based on BLS data, directly from BLS this morning. Non-seasonally adjusted, that's correct.
Yeah. So now, you know, look, 8%, you're right, 8% is not a great unemployment rate. 12% obviously much worse, and for some of those numbers we just saw, the numbers are even worse. What kind of a reality does that create? How bad, I mean, we always hear about, you know, college kids can't get jobs. How bad is it out there?
Well, according to Rutgers University, 50% of college grads ages 18 to 29 are either unemployed or underemployed. But then you have all the things that we all know now as anecdotal data that is actually supported by actual data. So when you hear stories about people moving back in with their parents or with other family members, that's correct. I mean, in our survey, 84% of young Americans indicated that the poor economy has impacted them, including changing their lifestyle and changing where they live. They're taking on more roommates, they're downsizing. But also on fundamental important things, 23% are putting off getting married, 31% are putting off having kids, 26% are putting off going to more education or grad school. So when you take a look at the demographic itself, I think you can honestly say this is a group of young Americans whose careers and dreams have been interrupted. But the other thing is this, when you look at them as a cohort in the labor force, you're looking at a generation that's been denied skills that they need in order to compete successfully here at home, but also on the world stage with workforces in China and India.
Yeah, you know, so look, and I'm sorry.
Okay, welcome back. So we cut it a little bit short because they go into politics and who should vote, and that's, you know, old news. But anyway, income, employment, right? You know, in sociology, we kind of take a look at not only how people organize themselves, but all these factors that influence us that are outside of ourselves. And if it's your first time, you know, joining us, you know, we'd like to remind you that you can always call in, you can always text in any comment, insight, or thought that you may have had while you were watching this or the rest of this program, right? The great thing about this class and being able to broadcast it live to, you know, via the internet and to everybody watching at home is that, you know, we all participate in this world, we all participate in this economy, and we all, for the most part, you know, most of us work, right? And, you know, some of these issues are things that we deal with. A couple things to keep in mind, you know, unemployment rate, right? We get this average. But within this average, you know, it influences or certain demographics certain populations, you know, in different ways. Like, for example, you know, we focused on young people, right? It was 12% overall. But then you saw a breakdown by race, right? 24% almost, well, double for, you know, young African-American men and women between the age of 18 and 29. Right? Or when we just took women as a cohort, right? As a group, as a population, you know, it was slightly lower than the average, 11.8, right? You know, in the coming weeks, we're going to explore this more and more. But because everything, you know, so much is tied to our income, right? You know, the unemployment rate is a very, you know, closely watched number. It, is something that reflects the health of our economy to a certain extent. You know, we must, you know, because it's a capitalist system, it requires consumption, right? It requires that individuals buy new cars, buy new clothes, or just buy, right? Right now during the holiday season, it's something that folks are going to watch very closely, right? See how much people are spending. You know, we talk about the consumer confidence index, right? Where the confidence of folks in not only the economy, but their own ability to, you know, spend money or whether they can afford to spend money is something that's watched, right? You know, because again, the more money that's spent, you know, the more that's consumed, the more money that circulates through the economy. And then, you know, if people are buying more things, that means people can hire more folks to make some of those things. And, you know, everything's tied together and vice versa. When, you know, the economy slowed down, people stopped buying things. And, whether it was manufacturing or some of these service industry jobs, you know, since people stopped consuming those services and goods, you know, people started losing their jobs, right? Anyhow, Sasha writes in. Do you believe that we are in a cyclical period with the job situation comparing to FDR's New Deal? Can this be the American century with an Obama version of the New Deal? There are similarities. Like the first thing I'll comment on is that because of our economic system, you know, the capitalist system, it is built on booms and busts. You know, this is kind of a natural part of the system, right? And we've had growth and collapse, you know, a few times over the last since the New Deal, since the Great Depression, and before that, right? You know, prior to the housing, the collapse, prior to the boom in housing, and then the eventual collapse, you saw something similar in the tech industry in the 80s. There was speculation in the junk bonds and, you know, savings and loan. You see the same thing, right? So, to a certain extent, part of that cycle rests in the economic system. But as far as the New Deal, you know, who knows? Some of the same circumstances don't exist. For example, One way, you know, and this is, you know, kind of putting it very, maybe I'm reducing it a little too much, but one thing that you could do in the 1930s or in 40s, you know, you could hire about like 100 people to dig a trench or dig a, you know, a hole where you can pour concrete for a foundation. You know, nowadays we don't generally do that. Construction equipment, something like an excavator or a bulldozer or something like that, can do the work of, you know, 50 or 100 men, right? So you can't hire as much. I mean, one of the good things that came out of the New Deal was something like the CCC, the Conservation Corps. You know, they built the, you know, if you go into the forests, you find a trail. Some of those trails were cleared out and built by the CCC, fire lanes, things like that. So, I mean, if we invest in infrastructure, that could be a possibility. But, you know, it's a Keynesian view. Some people have an issue with this, but, you know, if someone can, you know, if there's an entity that can absorb such a cost, it would be the federal government. So in some ways it might be true, but, you know, I think the circumstances are, you know, a little different, but we'll see, I guess. You know, history is always, you know, written from a perspective in the future. So since we're living it right now, it's kind of tough, but I don't really know. I really doubt if it's going to be really compared to like the New Deal. But what I really think is, you know, it's going to kind of, what we're living through right now is really going to typify life for the next few decades, right? Where we have kind of like a bifurcated economy, economy that's, you know, split in two, you know, where, you know, you're either, poor, but basically what we consider, you know, there's basically not going to be a clear middle anymore. You know, it's either going to be above what we consider middle class right now or below. So that's what I think. But, again, the juries are still out. But let's talk about the unemployment rate. You know, during the early years of the 21st century, the unemployment rate was ranged from as low as 4% in 2000. And when it was 4%, you know, a lot of folks were worried that it was way too low, right? A lot of folks questioned Alan Greenspan and some of the maneuvers he was making with, in his position, whether he was, you know, allowing the unemployment rate to drop too low, right? You know, it's going to make labor more expensive, and then, you know, you could have the reverse of a bubble, right? Or as high as 9.6%, you know, in 2010, right? So, you know, in just the last 10 years, we've seen extremes, right? And, you know, one comparison that's been made to the Depression era is, you know, just prior to the Depression, you had the what's considered the first Gilded Age, right? Where, you know, if you remember, you know, books or a film like The Great Gatsby, you know, people had a lot of wealth, had a lot of money. They were making money off of some of the same instruments, well, not exactly the same instruments, but, you know, from the stock market and things like that. So, you know, a lot of folks had a lot of wealth. Economy collapsed, a lot of people lost their shirts. And, you saw something much more extreme, you know, than what we're experiencing, but, you know, you had a depression there. So, again, there are, you know, comparisons, because prior to this, you know, during the housing boom, a lot of folks were making a tremendous amount of money. You know, folks were buying all kinds of luxury vehicles and things like that. You know, a lot of folks were saying that it was the second Gilded Age, but much the same way as before the Great Depression, you know, those things, you know, came to an end. It collapsed, right? So, you know, history does repeat itself. So, I mean, I guess if there's something that we can really bank on, it's that. But when we think about the employment rate, it's only a figure. It's a rough estimate of actual unemployment. And there's several assumptions that are made about employment and unemployment that go into this. First, unemployment is reckoned as a percentage of those unemployed within the total labor force. Thus, the size of the labor force affects the unemployment figure. So the more people you employ, the less people, right? The total is gonna vary. Second, the labor force is defined as consisting of all non-institutional men and women over 16. And now institutional, folks who are, in prison and whatnot, right? Either working for pay or unemployed and actively seeking work. You know, this is something that got a lot of attention, right? And why, the unemployment rate might tick up or might stagnate and stay the same. You know, it's based on, folks who actually are submitting jobless claims. And, there's different kinds of rates, too, that are looked at, initial jobless claims, right? That's an important one that lets us know which are the, new folks that are being kind of introduced to unemployment or losing their jobs. Those jobs are vanishing. But again, this is something that came up often, during this last, presidential election cycle, that a lot of folks, were giving up or were holding off finding employment till either the economy got better or till they figured out what they wanted to do, right? And some folks, go back to school. So again, if you're not actively looking for work, if you're not actively reporting it, it doesn't get counted. As we mentioned before, people who are imprisoned, even though they might produce labor and technically they're not working, but, some people inside the correctional institutional system have employment, they manufacture, but they're excluded, right? So, this forced labor pool or pool of individuals who are, incarcerated aren't counted either in the employment number or the unemployed number, right? And again, like we mentioned, discouraged workers who have quit for work, looking for work, we don't count those folks. So again, it creates kind of a paradox. It creates problems trying to calculate how good we're doing or how poorly we're doing as far as trying to gauge the economic recovery, right? And there's a number of tools that are used. Unemployment's not the same thing. Just to kind of go off on a side note, I think this is like interesting. One of the kind of most accurate ways to kind of gauge whether people are buying things or not, right, isn't really how much money is really being spent, but they can always get a pretty good calculation by the amount of, refuge containers that get leased out, right? Or basically when trash is hauled off, right? If you need to rent more, vehicles or, storage space to move that trash away from the city, that's a pretty good indicator because that means people are buying stuff and throwing stuff out, things of that nature. So I always thought that was interesting. But anyway, again, this official statistic, also doesn't really differentiate between full-time and part-time work. So to be officially employed, right, it requires putting in only 15 hours of work a week. Now, for some of you might be thinking, well, that's not enough to, if it was a minimum wage job, it's probably not enough to support a family or support an individual independently. However, that's not, the unemployment rate, and this is kind of the point, doesn't reflect whether a wage or the amount of hours someone's receiving is enough, right? It only reflects whether people are working or staying at home or looking for work. So to a fair degree, it obscures what we call underemployment or not being paid sufficiently or not working enough hours to live comfortably, right? Or to maintain a standard of living that's acceptable. Right. So, this and that was kind of one of my, pet peeves during the whole, you know, this last presidential cycle, everyone says jobs, we need more jobs, we need more jobs. But, you know, the one thing to remember is, okay, what type of jobs, right? Because if we're all just like working 5 hours a week for minimum wage or 20 hours a week for minimum wage, you know, it's going to be the standard of living is going to drop, right? Or as opposed to, you know, and sign me up for this kind of job, right? Like $3,000 a week for 3 hours of work. I don't know. I just made that up. I don't know if that really exists. But you can see where, you know, that would, you know, fall under the unemployed rate, but, you know, still sufficient to kind of live off of. But anyway, unfortunately, what we're faced in our society is this underemployment. You know, people not earning enough or working long enough or long enough hours a week to, again, live comfortably and kind of push this economy forward. Okay, so we're going to share something interesting with you to kind of diverge a second. You know, something that I came across is the rates at which unemployment is paid in error. And this is kind of helpful to kind of show you how problematic, you know, trying to figure out the unemployment rate really is. Because even when you have figured it out, sometimes certain states, and because, you know, certain states have different criteria, you end up paying individuals that may not qualify as unemployed. So this will be a short video, about a minute and a half, and then we'll be right back. So this is the unemployment paid in error, and then we'll be right back.
Each state in the union pays out jobless benefits, and the result is of the $46 billion that states distributed last year, 11% was paid out in error. That is almost three times the error rate in the food stamp program. So who's doing the best to keep errors at a minimum? We're going to start with Vermont. It overpaid by only 2.5%. One reason is because you need to file initially in person or by phone rather than other states, which offer an online option. Now, California is fourth best with a 5.74% error rate. But since California also pays out more in actual dollars, that means the state overpaid more than $400 million. Now, who are the biggest offenders? This is the other side of the equation. Indiana, it overpays by 45%. That's because it lets you qualify for jobless benefits even if you quit your job, as long as it's for a good cause. Ohio is fourth worst, overpaying by 18%. Virginia, fifth worst, overpaying by 17%. You don't even have to live in Virginia to qualify for unemployment. So what are the main reasons for these states overpaying? Well, after a claim is approved, authorities find out a person quit his job or was fired for just cause, or the government simply can't verify that the person claiming benefits actually looked for work. That is today's Off the Charts.
Okay, so a quick little diversion. Welcome back. And again, you know, as we go through our discussion today, you can feel free to call in, write in, share any thought, comment, or perspective that you might have. Again, we all work. Some of you may be or have faced unemployment. So, you know, we're looking at numbers, we're looking at statistics. You know, it's easy to say, okay, well, you know, 2010, 9.6% was extremely high. But the other thing is, how does, you know, unemployment feel, right? You know, what are the personal consequences? And this is what we're going to kind of segue into after we take a comment from James. With the economy, James writes in, with the economy going down and the costs of everything going up, I see a lot of competition among younger workforce versus the older generation. I'm speaking of people in their 60s and 70s. Your thoughts? Well, my thoughts are that, you know, a lot of folks, and we'll get to this eventually today, you know, in our discussion, is a lot of folks can't afford to stop working, right? Social Security or, you know, pensions, you know, aren't as abundant as they once were. Or Social Security isn't something that most people can live comfortably off of, right? The other thing is, you know, a lot of folks, because they're, you know, older, you know, still feel empowered. They still feel like they can do it. And, since work is such an entrenched part of our lives, you know, it makes up who we are and how we feel about ourselves. You know, a lot of folks keep working because it's a part of, again, their identity. But for the most part, I think, you know, when it's older and there's, you know, in their when folks are in their silver generation, you know, when they're in the 60s and 70s, you know, if they're working, chances are is either because they're a professional and they really enjoy it, right, and they're, you know, making a lot of money, or at the other end, they can't afford to, right? And, you know, it really depends who you ask, right? But anyway, I mean, it's a great comment, you know, and great question, James, and I'm glad you shared that with us, right? So moving forward, you know, the again, this the unemployment rate is just a snapshot, right? Again, it doesn't make a distinction between workers that are employed all year long or those who are temporarily employed, right? You know, you have these terms that are attached, like non-farm, you know, or right now, you know, something that depending on which chart you look at, might include the surge of temporary workers that are hired on because of the holidays, right? You know, you know, usually in October, November, September, December, you see an uptick because more, you know, people are working, you know, a couple hours, you know, at department stores and whatnot during that holiday rush, and then you see, the number go back up because of you know, folks losing those jobs because, you know, the demand isn't there. So, you know, for these reasons, you know, people are, you know, folks argue that the employment rate often, you know, provides an overly optimistic picture of employment and unemployment, right? You know, so, you know, these numbers are important. Again, you know, they give us an idea of what's really going on. But again, you know, it is problematic and often paints, again, a better, excuse the picture a little bit, you know, and we often have to ask, you know, deeper questions, which we're gonna do so today, right? So, you know, one thing we'll, you know, kind of start discussing right now is, are the personal consequences, right? So unemployment rates, you know, are cold statistics, like I said, they're numbers, but they signal, you know, harsh realities for individuals. You know, we might look at a unemployment rate for, you know, young African Americans, you know, and see 24%. But for, you know, if you identify this way, or if this is your, you know, if this number, you know, influences you, you know, it's, you know, those are things that you have to, you know, deal with, right? If you're unemployed right now, you know, this is a number, but, you know, from your perspective, you know, this number is, you know, not being able to pay the light bill, not having enough, you know, money for the holidays right now, right? So, you know, it is definitely problematic. So we'll go through some comments right now. Silvana writes in, I agree that some states overpay and do not follow up. I also feel that states like ours are employee friendly. So we see abuse from the system by citizens, right? And, you know, and that's with everything. You know, people can figure out how to work the system, right? And something that we'll, you know, that we've kind of discussed before, you know, in one of our videos and our lectures are that, you know, some folks are often accused of, you know, kind of, you know, putting off aggressively working or seeking employment because their unemployment either will pay them more than what's available, or, you know, they'll parlay it towards, you know, till something, they find something that really is advantageous for them, or a step up, if you will. But again, you know, a lot of folks are reaching that those 99 weeks where they get cut off. So, you know, again, you know, that's just, you know, individuals. But again, you know, with any system, with any bureaucracy, there will be some wiggle room or some opportunities for individuals to, you know, claim unemployment, right? Because, I mean, one side, you know, if you make it too restrictive, you know, you, like, for instance, Indiana was one of the highest, well, states with the highest erroneous payouts, right? But they also allow, you know, individuals to, you know, quit, right? So even if you were in a poor working condition, you might not quit, you know, in the state of California because you might not get employment, you know, unemployment. So it kind of binds you to a poor situation. Where in another state, you know, you can maybe save yourself some stress, or, you know, free yourself from that kind of, you know, I guess, oppression. Cynthia writes in, my company gets EDD queries. When someone because a person was collecting unemployment insurance after they started working. So, you know, Cynthia here, and this is a great part about the class, you know, she has, you know, kind of access to this experience where she sees folks who are, you know, in this process of developing new skills, right? So, you know, again, you know, and there's, you know, the system's there to kind of catch folks who are trying to double dip in this case, where they're working and collecting their unemployment insurance. Or, you know, some people might work, you know, under a table or something like that too. Cynthia writes in, retire should mean not having to work a nine to five job because you saved up enough to now do what you want. With the market crashes and low wages, this isn't very real, right? Excellent comment. Emmy writes in, funny how all the states erroneously paid for unemployment are red states or swing states who prefer smaller government. You know, well, that's actually a pretty good observation, right? You know, or, you know, the other one that, you know, kind of reminds me of what Emmy just said, you know, a lot of the states that lean towards less taxation and smaller governance, less taxation, receive larger sums than, you know, some big states like ours, you know, that we kind of get shortchanged a little bit, right? Because, you know, maybe because of our because our electorate is extremely predictable. But before we go on, you know, I do want to share one more video on making sense of unemployment. You know, the different categories. And again, it's going to kind of wrap up some of the ideas that we've shared with you thus far. It's a short video, about 4 minutes, you know, from our friends at, you know, PBS. But anyway, this is called Making Sense of Unemployment. You know, and we'll take a quick look at it. And then we'll transition to, again, the personal consequences of unemployment.
Vasan, I am joined by the magic of telephones and cables and cameras by Paul Solomon, who is going to help us make sense today of the unemployment numbers. The unemployment numbers came out this morning, Paul, and they say it's down to 9%, and there's a net creation of 36,000 jobs. They've revised last year's numbers to about 950,000 jobs created instead of 1 million. What does this all mean?
You know, it is truly the most daunting, most difficult unemployment day that I can remember. On the one hand, you have the establishments, the companies of America, saying, well, we hardly created any jobs at all, 36,000, you know. That's not anywhere near enough to compensate for the increase in the population. On the other hand, unemployment number plunges.
There are better measures out there besides the 10% unemployment or 9% unemployment that we hear politicians kind of batting around is this key
right.
number. Well, how do we get to that number? What is that number?
The headline number is called U3, unemployment 3. Then the government does report a U4, a U5, a U6. That's people who have been looking, but not recently. The government adds them back in for U4 and U5. And for U6, it's the government also adds people who are working part-time but looking for, or say they're looking for, a full-time job.
So what's a U7 and how do we get there?
This number, U7, adds in everybody who says they want a job and everybody who's working part-time but says they're looking for full-time work, because there are people who work an hour in the last week and are considered employed because that's part-time work. So if you add all those people in, you've got a number now which is, as of today, is 17.8% as opposed to the official 9%, so almost double. In any case, it's about 30 million Americans.
So 18% or 17%, these are tough numbers for anybody out there in politics land, just on the other side of the river from where we are, to swallow.
This is a huge problem for people across the river from you. I'm sure people on the same side of the river as you. People here on the frozen river where I am in Boston. And everywhere else. It's just an extremely high level at a point at which the economy is supposedly coming out of recession. Ben Bernanke, the chairman of the Fed, just this week said the unemployment number hasn't come down sufficiently for us to stop worrying about it. I mean, that it's a long, long time to go before we get to normal unemployment. I mean, we think of full employment in this country as about somewhere between 4 and 5%. That's still a number that's half what today's 9% is, if you believe today's 9%.
Have you seen data that supports the creation of a new number? Have you seen other economists try to come up with this new number that you're working on as well?
I'm not doing something that's out at all outlandish here. I'm literally coming up with a number that's reported every month, and you can make what you will of it. That is, people, Americans who, when asked, say, "I want a job." What, and Americans who say, "I'm working part-time, but I want a full-time job." The most inclusive number, it seems to me, is something we should all be aware of. Because I'll tell you, Hari, you know, I do get out there a lot. I'm talking to people. I was interviewing people up here in Boston yesterday, one woman who didn't have a job and was telling me that there were no jobs out there. She has a degree from Lehigh. She's one of the most articulate people I've interviewed in months. And those people will consistently say to you, I know that the unemployment number is much higher than the number that's being reported. And I think what they're sensing is, in fact, the kind of the number that we're trying to report here on the NewsHour Net.
So welcome back. Okay. Right there, we got, you know, kind of wrapped up everything we were discussing about the unemployment rate, how we get to it. And again, you know, as we transition to this discussion on the personal consequences of unemployment, do feel free to call in, write in, right? You know, some of us, you know, might be employed, you know, like part-time, and we would like full-time employment. Others are looking every day and, you know, with little success, or perhaps finding only jobs that would be insufficient for them to surrender their unemployment. So anyway, again, you can write in and text in, or call us in and we'll take you live on the air. But anyhow, you know, these are just numbers, but, you know, we're talking about these personal consequences. Like, for instance, when many folks experience a job loss, they also lose or begin to lose some of their benefits, right? Like health care, things of that nature. Most of us, you know, again, and this is the difference between having wealth and income. Most of us depend on a stream of income and have very little wealth. So when that stream of income dries up, it's only a matter of time before we start, going into what little we own or little we save. And, you know, those have kind of a cascading effect where, poverty, you know, just, you know, just. Just like, you know, it takes money to make money, so the more money you have, the more money you can make, the less you have, right, the worse you're off, right? You know, it kind of compounds itself, right? You know, people make decisions, and, you know, one thing we can have a sense for is, you know, some of the psychological problems people or folks who are unemployed or underemployed face, you know, something like stress, right? You know, stress is often, you know, linked to not only, you know, to our roles, right? For instance, you know, the obligations that an individual has to their family, right, is often a great producer of stress, right? So it's not only, you know, a person trying to provide, you know, the means for their own survival, but, you know, if they have a family, children, you know, it becomes, you know, multiplied, right? Something to kind of keep in mind is that oftentimes we do associate our status, our identity with the type of work we do, but also with the roles that we fill within our family. So if you're a father or mother and you can't provide, you know, what you would like, or the, you know, or you're not meeting all the needs for your family, you know, you internalize that, right? You know, people can, you know, who aren't working might see themselves as a bad mother or a bad father, you know, because again, you know, they don't have the ability to, or the stream of income that's necessary, right? There's also, to a certain degree, a link to the, you know, satisfaction people have with their lives. You know, if they're unemployed, you know, just to kind of throw this out there, you know, our employment, and this is maybe going all the way back to the Protestant ethic, like our employment, you know, or status as employed is often linked to our worth in society, right? So often people, you know, if they're not working, you know, feel like, you know, for lack of a better term, you know, worthless, right? When they're really not, you know, they're, you know, they very much have something to contribute to society, but that's the way people internalize it and others kind of see it, right? So it does become problematic, right? The other things that are kind of, you know, not only do we talk about stress being psychological, it also has a physiological or a link to physical health, right? You know, people who are jobless, right, often report a higher level of cholesterol, elevated blood pressure, and, you know, there's higher rates of drug and alcohol use found, you know, in folks who are jobless or unemployed, right? And, you know, this is all tied to, you know, how people manage their stress, right? You know, when folks, you know, turn to alcohol, turn to, you know, substances to kind of self-medicate themselves, you know, that's where addictions can arise. So, you know, in turn, you know, something like unemployment correlates with high levels of family violence, right? To a certain extent, you know, since, and the scale works like this, you know, the biggest victims of family violence are always children, right? Because family violence is sometimes, it's often rooted to power, right? Or the lack of power in another sphere of family life. So, you know, children being the smallest shareholders of power inside a family often, you know, receive the most abuse. You know, next are women, you know, especially in traditional relationships, and then men often are the aggressors, right? One way it's linked, you know, in that kind of scenario where you have a traditional family where it's a male and a father, a mother, and children, right? The male can be, you know, disempowered by his economic situation, because remember, a status like breadwinner is closely tied to masculinity and what a father is, right? Often, you know, internalizes that, creates stress, and you know, often that aggression is displaced or projected on, you know, to the other family members, right? And if that occurs, you know, sometimes, you know, not only are, you know, the mother and the child kind of abused by, you know, this male figure, but, you know, female figures will, you know, then in turn project or, you know, kind of, you know, displace some of that aggression onto children. So they kind of, children kind of get it twice in the end. But again, you know, these are real issues people face because of the situations that arise in life, right? Namely, in this discussion, unemployment, right? So, you know, given this, given all these negative things that are associated with unemployment, and, you know, job security is a major concern, right? On the one hand, it's often assumed that globalization and technology change have produced less secure environments, right? On the other hand, little change in overall job security has occurred from the mid-70s to the mid-90s. You know, this was evident, right? So when we think about, you know, job insecurity, right? You know, especially for those of you who are taking the class right now, you know, this is something that perhaps has led you to, you know, the applied studies program, or, you know, something that you're considering as you pursue a degree. You know, a degree will give you more leverage in the job market, right? So, you know, for as far as job security, certain you know, we have to look at it as, you know, as far as categories. You know, job insecurity has increased for individuals who are less educated, who perform manual labor. You know, since their jobs are de-skilled, they have the least amount of job security, right? These are the folks that are truly threatened by globalization, the outsourcing of work, right? You know, while other folks, because of the, you know, shifting needs in the economy, you know, probably have more security, right? Something like, you know, folks in the service, you know, industry at the higher levels or in the medical field, you know, are continually needed, right? But if it's de-skilled, if you can ship it in a container, you know, your job might be at risk, right? So, again, you know, these are things that, you know, we definitely deal with. Now we want, you know, what I want to discuss are the varieties of employment, since we kind of talked about the unemployment number, what it is. You know, again, it's clear that employment is central to our lives. You know, but, you know, not everyone has, you know, the kind of same outlooks on what employment is. And we're going to talk about, you know, other kinds of employment, like military service and whatnot. So, you know, in 2010, nearly 71.3 million men aged 20 or older, not in the military service or in prison, were employed, right? And for the equivalent cohort of women, the figure was something around 63.5 million, right? So again, most of us will seek employment, will want to be employed. So when we break it down by age and time period, changes emerge, right? So the rate of the labor force participation for women increased across, you know, all categories since the 1970s, right? You know, but the same isn't true for men, especially those between 55 and 65. And there's a slight increase in the employment of older men in recent years, right? You know, older men, you know, are working longer, right? And again, we kind of discussed some of the factors, you know. You know, this is going on. So, you know, something that we've celebrated too, and we'll continue to kind of expand on, are, you know, is the participation of women inside the economy. And, you know, something that I want to throw out there, you know, to a certain extent, for most folks, a dual income within the family is a necessity. So this really kind of propels the inclusion of women inside the workforce. Not, you know, unfortunately, it's not so much for egalitarian reasons, but economic necessity, you know, is kind of really driving it. But there, you know, there's, you know, a couple other things going on. So for older men, you know, kind of, you know, entering the workforce, we talked about the erosion of Social Security. But also, you know, health has gotten better. So, you know, people are able to work longer because they're healthier, right? There's also propensity to retire is also conditioned by, again, income and the prestige associated with a job. If it's a high prestige job, right, you know, it may be, you know, something someone might not want to surrender as lightly. You know, one of the big things when folks get ready to retire, right, is that, you know, there, it's going to be an identity shift, right? And, you know, this is something that, you know, I can't stress enough, you know. When we are employed, when we identify or create our identity of who we are, it's often linked in adulthood to what we do every day, right? And then, you know, not everyone kind of saddles themselves with their identity as far as what they do for employment. But when, again, you're a professional, it very much becomes part of your status, right? It very much becomes who you are, right? It's how you present yourself. So, you know, again, because of the number of factors, you know, some folks are working longer because of economic necessity, but others, you know, find that either the remuneration is good or that the status is worth keeping. And again, if their health is there, you know, more power to them. But, you know, it does, you know, bring up some questions, like whether they're, you know, keeping others from, you know, advancing in their careers or, you know, preventing someone from the opportunity of holding that position. Now, what I want to do next is we want to talk about part-time work, right? Now, we are going to take a little, we're going to watch a small, short video, right? It should be a little, you know, we've been dealing with a lot of negative numbers, but this should be somewhat positive, right? This video is going to describe that or show that part-timers currently are not driving employment. So that's a positive thing, right? So, you know, more people are becoming fully employed. That's an encouraging sign, but still the number's kind of high. So let's take a quick look at that now, and then we'll be right back. And this video is from October, so it's very recent and still valid. So we'll be right back after that.
Household employment and said this is because so many additional people were working part-time, got part-time jobs for economic reasons. A lot of economists have looked at this and sent me this chart. I put it together. I don't want to give credit to anyone in particular because so many people figured this out. But you look first at the white line, that is the number of people who got jobs for part-time jobs for economic reasons. That did jump. But the red line, the total number of people, I guess it shows up yellow, the total number of people working part-time, total number of people working part-time fell.
That's great.
So the white line number contains people who had maybe full-time jobs but had their hours cut back, and it does not suggest that we are becoming a nation of part-timers or that companies hired a whole bunch of part-time workers because they're not hiring full-time
workers. Let's go.
Quick video. But yeah, a little positive news. But let's talk about what part-time work means, right? So, you know, it's anything, you know, less than 35 hours, right? But, you know, we were just talking about retirees. Many retirees still work part-time, right, on a part-time basis. You know, usually when we think about part-time and why it was so worrying or still is worrying, is that it's often seen as something that you do on a side, not something that you need to survive on, right? You know, the significant number of young workers are part-time workers. Part-time workers or part-time work has increased as a result of the Great Recession, you know, this economic downturn that we're living through right now. And you know, it, to a certain extent, it does reflect the opportunities that are out there. But on the other hand, there are folks who prefer part-time work, right? This is an arrangement that within their life works, right? So, you know, typically we consider part-time, you know, anything below 35 hours, but, you know, anything above is considered full-time. There are differences between gender and part-time work. About 24.8% of women fall into this category, while 21.9% of men fall into the category. And workers under the age of 25 account for about a quarter of part-time workers, right? So before we go to the downside of part-time work, we're going to take a comment by Shirley. Shirley writes back, I agree that the unemployment rate may not accurately depict the state of our economy. I come across many people in my job that have bachelor's, even master's degrees, which are still looking for part-time income, right? Can you go back up? I can't see. Are still looking for part-time income because they simply cannot find a job in their field. So in turn, they end up taking a job that will simply pay the bills, but that does not require a degree. More and more, we are seeing people take part-time jobs or jobs away from their field just to pay the bills, right? You know, and again, you know, there's a line between necessity and, you know, what we would like to live in. Again, thank you, Shirley, for providing that insight. So anyhow, to continue this discussion of part-time work, one of the negatives, sides of part-time work is that, often people, for the most part, receive lower wages and salaries, right? And this is on average. So both men and women are paid less, but men take a larger hit. Both genders are also likely to be covered. Both genders or folks who are part-time are less likely to be covered by pensions and healthcare, right? We also have to consider, temporary workers, right? This is a category of workers that can be full or part-time. So, the U.S. Department of Labor refers to these workers as contingent workers. So their employment is not open-ended, right? Rather, the term contingent, is on contract or agreement or an agreement between them and an employer. So, this is often, these folks are often found in the service sector, whether it's, agricultural or, some contingent workers also work in, the high-tech sector, right? Something like software developers, system analysts, technical writers, right? And a more typical contingent worker, again, are those who are temporarily employed to do routine office work, right? Temps, right, is the term. So, again, these are, you might work 40 hours a week, you might be full-time or you might be part-time, but again, it's temporary, right? So to a certain extent, the job security isn't there, right? But, so far we've been talking about work where you receive remuneration, right? But we also have to kind of take into account work that isn't paid, right? Or work without pay. Well, generally outside the home, but the largest category of workers excluded from the official statistics, are folks who work without pay because they receive no remuneration, or full-time homemakers, right? This is something that, homemakers, in particular women, have not received the kind of, attention or valuation, I should say, that they're deserving of, right? Something that we discussed shortly before, like during the Industrial Revolution, the work actually done inside the home was very important for the Industrial Revolution because it maintained the worker. Even today, raising children, doing housework is still important. Although it shouldn't be gendered, it often is. And, although for a very long time, men, got all the attention, got the gold star on their chest because, they were the breadwinner. Women, for the most part, are filling in the ranks, preparing the next generation to take over and maintaining, everyone in the family. And this often went unpaid, right? That's changed since. The big thing is it's not, homemaking is not a, something to be ashamed of or anything, but, and the reason I say that is because oftentimes, the misconception is that, if someone wants to be a homemaker, especially if they're a woman, they often get chastised, right? The key thing is to, if you want to do it, just know you're doing it because you want to, not because you're being forced in by these gender roles. And if you're male, that's fine too, right? They're gendered in, through norms in our society, but really it's, something that both folks in a relationship should see to. Anyhow, so again, homemakers, again, have been penalized by the rules governing Social Security. If you're a homemaker, even though you are producing labor, you're supporting, the economy indirectly, you don't get to receive any of the wealth tied to it, or any money earned over one's working life, right? A full-time housewife has access to survivor benefits upon, you know, the death of a working husband. But again, housewives have no direct claim to the Social Security system unless they have worked for pay at some point. So you can see where, you know, there's a great bit of inequality right there. And, you know, it kind of maintains the subservience of women in the domestic role, or someone in a domestic role when that happens. The other contingent of unpaid work consists of volunteers of all kinds. This is something that we're going to kind of focus on, right? Volunteer activities include fundraising, coaching teams, refereeing games, tutoring, preparing food, serving food, you know, anything that you would do as volunteer work, unpaid work, right? So volunteer work is, you know, commonly performed by organizations, religious organizations, not-for-profit organizations. And this amount of work done by volunteers is by no means trivial, right? It really matters. Some, you know, one thing we're going to explore today is that some organizations depend on it. They wouldn't exist if volunteering or internships didn't exist. So, for example, in 2008 and 2009, 63.4 million, right? This is about 24.6% of the U.S. population over the age of 16. So 63.4 million individuals put in at least one stint of volunteer work, right? The median amount of time spent volunteering was about 50 hours per year, right? That's a great deal. Among the economic contributions it makes, volunteer work is advantageous to the worker, right? For example, if an individual is retiree, you know, they gain a great number of benefits, right? One, you know, and it's, again, all these things that we associate with work, the culture of work, it's the routine. You actually get to meet people, you make social connections, you socialize, you get out of the house, you create a social role. So, you know, this benefits you and your identity. So it's, you know, mentally healthy. And then, you know, again, it's psychologically good for you, and, you know, maybe even physically good for you. So, you know, volunteering is associated with greater well-being for those with low income or poor health, right? You know, it's one of those things that, you know, because, again, you know, the quality of who we see, how we see ourselves and how we see our lives is so linked to the labor we produce, the employment that we have, or the things that we do, you know, volunteering is something that is healthy. But we also want to explore internships. So what we're going to do next, we're going to watch a short segment on internships and whether or not they're worth it. Because one of the arguments is that because of internships, because of apprenticeships, you know, this unpaid labor, you know, these are jobs that people could be earning income for, right? So to a certain extent, because some companies use interns, right? They don't have to hire someone and they save some money or maybe make a bigger profit if they're a for-profit industry. On the other side, and this is, again, an argument that you're going to hear, some organizations, some endeavors, some enterprises wouldn't be able to exist if it wasn't for interns or volunteers. So let's take a quick look at that, and then we'll be right back.
It's vacation season in America, and families are flocking to popular destinations,
run!
Like Colonial Williamsburg in Virginia. They come here for the 18th century experience.
You can doff your hat.
But in one respect, Williamsburg is as modern as any 21st century city.
I am an historical interpretations intern.
The place is crawling.
I am an intern.
With interns.
I just happened to see on the website that they had an internship.
More than 100.
Good day, and how are you this day?
Even Thomas Jefferson isn't sure what to make of them.
What do you think of internships?
Internship. And I beg your pardon, Ms. Smith, but I'm not too familiar with the word internship.
Intern Sam Cady makes tools in the furniture shop, while intern Erica Moses digs for artifacts.
So this dance we're going to teach you today is called Haste to the Wedding.
Intern Lauren James teaches colonial dancing.
We're going to go around in a circle for 8 counts.
For Lauren, it's a dream job, except for one thing.
Are you getting paid?
I'm not getting paid. I'm not. I'm getting paid in experience, I feel.
In experience?
So, in experience.
And does experience pay the rent?
It doesn't, but family friends have been very, very generous to me this summer.
Now, why not pay your interns?
I'd like to pay the interns. I mean, it really is a matter of finances.
Jay Gaynor is director of historic trades at Williamsburg. He says internships are a win-win. The kids get experience, and the employers?
The greatest benefit for us is that we get some extra help when we need some extra help. I mean, it's just very straightforward. We get some new blood, these young kids that have a different perspective on things, and that's exciting.
All work for little or no pay. That's the intern's lot. And today, there are lots of them, from Yosemite to SeaWorld to the White House, and just about everywhere in between.
Internships are almost a trend. They are so popular today. Everybody wants these internships.
Hey, nice to meet you.
Lauren Berger calls herself the intern queen, for good reason. She talked her way into 15 college internships, all unpaid.
And if I went back in time, I would do it all over again. For me, those internships just helped me learn so much about myself and about what I wanted to do. And it was information that I wasn't getting in the classroom.
While most colleges have career centers to help place students, resources vary widely. So after graduating, Berger started an internship information website because she knows kids are getting desperate.
The most common question that employers are asking in that job interview after graduation is, where did you intern? And if the person next to you even had one internship and you didn't, there's a good chance that that other person is going to land the opportunity.
In a 2010 survey, 42% of college students who graduated with an internship on their resume received a job offer, compared to just 30% for students with no intern experience. And those graduates with internships received a higher starting salary, about $42,000, compared to just $35,000 for those without. The message is loud and clear.
I'm interning at Alexander Wang.
Prudential.
My intern at New York City Parks and Recreation.
I'm interning at Lancome.
How hot are internships? In New York City earlier this month, Lauren Berger threw a small party for interns to meet and greet and got a lot more than she bargained for.
My name is Eric and I'm from CBS.
We're with CBS News. Is it okay if we just ask you a few questions?
We thought it was appropriate to have our own Sunday morning interns cover the event.
Is the internship that you're in now, is that paid or unpaid?
It is unpaid.
Ian Goldstein, Erica Mahoney, and Brianna Berg helped research this report, and it was an eye-opening experience.
Since you guys are in this unique position of being interns and doing a story on internships, what has surprised you most about digging into this?
I was really surprised by the fact that so many people are against internships being unpaid. There were a lot of people that I found who were like, it's illegal, it's unfair, I was so surprised that so many people were saying that.
People like Ross Eisenbray.
Are interns getting a raw deal?
Absolutely they're getting a raw deal. And many of them don't know it.
Eisenbray is vice president of the Economic Policy Institute, a nonprofit Washington think tank. Unpaid internships, he says, are taking paid jobs away from people who need them.
This is a concern that economists have. Why isn't business hiring people? Well, if they can have people work for free, why should they hire anyone? And in fact, I'd say, you know, if they could get them to work 60 or 70 hours a week without paying them, so much the better. They don't have to pay them overtime. I mean, where does this stop?
And there's another problem, Eisenbray says. Increasingly, the top big city internships are going to kids from the top of the income ladder.
Who can afford to come to Washington and spend $4,000 on housing and food and then work without being paid? It is not the children of farm workers or factory workers or the children of people who are unemployed right now. It's going to be upper middle class kids.
One important thing about
Sunday morning intern Erica Mahoney agrees
Like all 75 summer interns at CBS, she receives a $50 per week stipend.
My parents are helping me out a lot, and you know, it's hard to think about that because I have friends who wouldn't be able to do something like this. And so, you know, every day I call my parents and I tell them everything about my day because I know that, like, that's how I can show my appreciation. So
you seem to feel a little guilty about this.
I do. I think it's hard because I know that I see so much potential in people who may or may not be able to be here too.
What's wrong with working for free? If a kid says, I want to do it, I want the experience, what's wrong with that?
Well, you could say that about the entire labor market. If they could persuade people to work for half of the minimum wage, if they could get adults to work for free for 6 months, not just young people, then why not? What's wrong with that? Well, it degrades the entire value of work.
But in this economy, some people would rather work for free than not work at all.
This is our barn. This is where the Ice Bears play.
And they're not just kids.
Normally during a game, I sit way over there.
After 10 years fundraising for various nonprofit groups in Knoxville, Tennessee, Christina Shands found herself suddenly unemployed.
It literally was within 15 minutes. I had no job, I had no insurance, I had nothing.
A lifelong hockey fan, she took a bold step and at age 38, talked her way into an unpaid internship with a minor league hockey team, the Knoxville Ice Bears.
I just started working the games, doing press releases, helping with any promotions and marketing. And so I did that for the entire 2009-2010 season. It was strange at times. You know, I'm working with 20-year-olds and I'm almost twice their age.
But it worked. That unpaid intern is now a paid media consultant.
You got to be able to think big and then have the guts to kind of start from the bottom. And maybe you'll hit the jackpot like I did.
We're going to pass out a page from a dancing booklet. So you
back in Colonial Williamsburg, the jackpot page, is right? Exactly what intern Lauren James is hoping to hit.
Let's all try that together. All summer I've been saying that hopefully this is a 3-month job interview. Hopefully this will catapult my career and do great things for me because this really has been such a learning summer.
One good thing about Williamsburg.
Good day, mistress.
You can always turn to Thomas Jefferson for advice. So is it wise to work for no money?
Yes, I would take the risk and pursue certain employment, whatever it may be, without the benefit of immediate remuneration, but for the benefit of immediate enlightenment. And that might further lead to an opportunity that will pay, and perhaps pay far the better than I would have ever thought at the beginning.
Okay, so welcome back. Right there we saw a video on internships. And some important questions, right? If you feel like calling in, writing in, and commenting, right? Perhaps you agree this is an unfair subsidy. Perhaps if you're a competing business and they're able to hire just interns or have interns, you know, that'll drive down costs and, you know, hurt you, right? Or perhaps it's a necessity today, right? You know, this idea that we're an explorer of work as a school or where you learn, you know, is something that is, you know, kind of the foundation of internships, right? You know, and it goes back to this idea that, when people are trying to sort through candidates for a job, an internship, you know, kind of shows that an individual is not only willing to work, able to work, but has sacrificed their own time and and pursued this effort without any any money, any remuneration, any wage, right? If anything, it costs them to participate in this, right? But anyway, just, you know, feel free to call in, write in, and share your comments. So this idea of work as school, right? We're going to kind of explore some different aspects of it. But always remember, you know, at the workplace, you know, it's always a situation where a great deal of learning takes place, right? Work-related learning is part of this process of socialization and where you actually learn by doing the work itself. So maybe, you know, something inside the internship, if you can, you know, this world of internships, if you can get into a field where you have aspirations of pursuing something at a, you know, at a more professional level, you know, that's a great advantage that you can have, right? So as much as, you know, one third or one half of the development of job-related skills, again, takes place after the individual leaves school, right? In some cases, job learning has been deliberately and closely connected to employment, right? So one prominent model is what we find in Germany, in the German training system, right? Half of German high school students participate in the program, and which combines formal education and work. After completing an apprenticeship, I should say, student skills are certified through examinations, right? After successful completion, some folks are offered starting wages considerably higher than those in most industrial nations, right? But this also requires early selection on, you know, of what you want to be, right? Of this lifelong occupation. So, you know, it might be slightly problematic, you know, if you kind of put all your eggs in one basket, right? One of the great things about education and pursuit of an education in academia is that, you know, many folks are still trying to figure out what they want to do, you know, in life. But this apprenticeship system is also kind of an extension of the past in some ways, right? You know, the apprenticeships, you know, if you recall from our early discussions, were, you know, an institution or what people did in pre-industrial economies, right? Now this, you know, changed, you know, creating a larger, more impersonal labor market when the Industrial Revolution came around. But again, you know, it used to be the way folks did things, right? And I mean, there's, you know, a big advantage because, again, you know, when you're training on the job, you know, you're actually doing it under the supervision of someone who knows. So, you know, the likelihood of being, you know, trained inside a company by a worker, right, not only trains someone in how a company wants something done, but also, you know, reduces, you know, if this person's hired on, it reduces the likelihood of the employee jumping ship too soon, right? And workers often expect to have a longer term relationship with the company, right? We'll talk about social bonds a little later, but you know, that also helps, right? You know, in the United States, you know, formal apprenticeships are rare, but we do have internships, right? The job training still exists. So informal training programs, you know, some employers use it. There's advantages to it, right? This idea of learning by doing is in large part, you know, the ethos of it, the way of, you know, well, the learning by doing, you know, it's, again, like I said, it's the mantra, if you will. But, you know, there's very few fields that, well, not very few, but, you know, not every, you know, organization can do this, right? It's mostly, you know, the larger ones where they have the ability to, you know, employ more than one individual within this, you know, said occupation, right? So, again, you know, these benefits aren't shared equally. You know, in one study, it noted that 35% of college graduates received such training, but only 19% of high school graduates did the training. We also have to deal with some ascribed statuses that also affect access. It's more likely for whites to kind of enter these training programs compared to African Americans or Latinos. Mid-career workers, again, are kind of, or older workers are kind of isolated from this too, right? You know, they're less likely to get an opportunity like an apprenticeship or an internship than a younger worker, right? And again, you know, gender is also influential and often confines folks to, you know, these different roles, right? So, you know, this is all kind of, you know, tied into, you know, the economic opportunities we have and, you know, how we build human capital, right? And when we kind of take this, you know, viewpoint or kind of framework of the, you know, human capital theory, the more we do, the more we learn, the more we kind of invest in ourselves, right? So the more training and education we can receive or access, you know, kind of alleviates the pressure or our susceptibility to unemployment and often advances our own fortunes and, you know, ability in the labor market, right? But again, you know, there are problems within this kind of paradigm. Training programs, again, are not directly tied to, you know, an actual job sometimes, and they have a mixed record of putting people in employed positions, right? For example, you know, in our short video, a lot of folks, you know, were seeking out internships, and when they could receive it, you know, in the field that they would like, you know, there was still a competition to kind of get those jobs, right? I mean, again, you know, the benefit is that any edge you can get is great, but, you know, it's not a, you know, 100% determinant, you know, factor that determines everything, right? You know, some, you know, some work is, you know, also threatened, right? Because of a globalization. Like, for instance, you know, one thing that, you know, folks have to keep in mind is that, you know, not only is the economy changing, but with that change, the landscape of employment is also changing. So the training programs people go into or the kind of organizations they go into, you know, they have to be aware that, you know, the way that things are done in some of these places, you know, may be antiquated or maybe filled with an old way of doing things, which may not necessarily be a bad thing, but, you know, can be problematic. So for the last couple of, you know, minutes, what I wanted to address is work and social interaction, right? Now, since the start of the class, we kind of built this story or kind of reminded you all that, you know, most of our lives will be tied or linked to what we do, to work, right? We talked about, you know, where we live, you know, being influenced by our work, right? Of course, people want to live close to work, but also, you know, the type of remuneration, the wages that they're getting paid will also influence what kind of living situation they can afford. But one thing that we haven't spent as much time on is the social interaction, right? This part of work that we all experience and, you know, perhaps, you know, the part of work that isn't so much linked to the actual work we do, you know. Since we spend most of our time at work, most of our friendships, most of our relationships will emerge from it, right? If you consider school a workplace, right? You know, not only college, but K-12, right? That kind of explains why so many of your friends were from the school you went to or exclusively from the school you went to, right? As you become an adult, you know, you might shift away from those friends, right? From not only high school, but college, because you don't see them as often, but the folks you see every day or you interact with the most are those who are, you know, with you every day at work. So, you know, it can be beneficial, right? Because again, most kinds of work, you know, require sustained and sometimes intense interaction with other people, with other workers, I should say. And for better or worse, it can be a pleasant experience or it can cause unpleasant stress, right? But for the most part, you know, work as a, you know, for adults becomes the primary site for socialization with other folks and a place where strong bonds are formed. So, you know, this is a big shift from, you know, the prior to the Industrial Revolution, where, you know, the family was a place where folks would socialize, right? But, you know, again, you know, you can think about your work schedule, right? Like a comparison or something, an idea that I can kind of throw out there. You know, oftentimes, you know, people are trying to make arrangements to meet or to spend time together, right? And often the works, you know, their work schedules don't line up, so that, you know, naturally keeps them apart. So, you know, you can think of work and the scheduling we do around it as something that creates opportunity or constraints on the type of relationships or with whom we can have relationships with, right? So, you know, whenever you hear or you might say this to a friend you don't see that often, maybe during the holidays, like, we should really spend more time together. You know, think about what, you know, that's a result of, right? Well, the result is probably, you know, this juggling act that we all kind of participate in or kind of are involved with, you know, as far as trying to not only have meet our, you know, occupational obligations, but our obligations outside the home, right? But again, you know, one of the ways we kind of work through that is, you know, many of our relationships will be at work. So, again, you know, many workplaces contain ample number of potential friends. Collective work can be the basis of socializing while getting work done. So it's, you know, that's something important to kind of keep in mind, right? You know, while you do the actual work, you know, people are coming together, you're sharing interests, sharing goals. And again, you know, this can cause stress because not everyone, will share the same interests or invest as much effort as others. But again, alternatively, forming friendships may be inhibited in work situations where workers are separated by physical or spatial barriers. Think about, cubicles, right? One of the reasons cubicles are kind of deployed and implemented is, you know, based on this idea that folks won't be as efficient working, you know, if they're, you know, able to talk to each other, see each other. Therefore, isolation is a positive thing. However, from the worker side, again, isolation leads to alienation. So there's a give and take with that. You know, the positive is that, okay, well, yes, you know, if you keep a person isolated, you know, they'll work. But, you know, you'll probably get, more work done or it'll be more efficient. The other thing is, job dissatisfaction can arise from that. So, you know, there has to be a balance. Because, again, when contact is limited, workers will naturally tend to find primary socializations opportunities among workers in similar situations. So this, in turn, contributes to occupational subcultures. And, you know, this occupational subculture that you kind of cultivate, and this is something that we've kind of looked at in the past, can be a positive or negative one, right? So some jobs are essentially solitary activities that prevent work from serving as a basis of socialization. We also have to keep that in mind. For example, people at work from home, or, you know, parents that stay at home, they don't get to socialize as much because, again, parenting and housemaking is a job. For women, even with jobs that take them away from home, there's difficulties forming relationships. And again, sometimes that time is split because of the obligations with family, right? So, just as, you know, kind of wrap that idea up briefly, you know, these interconnections, you know, and the subcultures they can create, you know, one thing we're learning now is that, you know, if done correctly, it's fair to put it this way, or, you know, manipulating the subculture a certain way can be beneficial to, you know, companies, corporations, and enterprises, right? You know, people like where they work, you know, It can be a positive thing. Now, where it's negative, right, if it becomes a distraction, if work doesn't get done, one of the biggest enemies of work is interruption, right? So if people are constantly interrupting each other and socializing, well, you know, that's where isolation may be a little bit more beneficial, right? So, I mean, if you're in a position to manage, it's something that you have to kind of consider and think about, right? You know, how do you kind of control that? But moving forward, social relationships and job performance. So again, one of the key things about, you know, when folks manage or oversee individuals is how to keep, you know, the workers motivated, right? And again, social relationships motivate workers. So, you know, one of the things that, you know, or one of the theories that we're going to kind of explain or introduce is this idea of the Hawthorne effect. The Hawthorne effect, again, is the tendency for workers to improve their performance when being observed, right? When someone's watched, they will, again, improve their performance. So, you know, be aware of being this fact that they're under surveillance, right? And, I mean, you could take it a step further with, you know, certain surveillance techniques like cameras and things of that nature, right? You know, the one thing to keep in mind is that, like, when you go to a grocery store or things like that, the cameras aren't merely there to kind of curb crime or to curb a employee from maybe, you know, stealing from a company, but it's also to kind of, take advantage of this Hawthorne effect. If people know that they're being recorded, that they're being watched, that a manager can go back and say, oh, you weren't doing this, you weren't doing that, and there's proof, right? People are much more likely to respond to that and to act within, you know, prescribed parameters, right? There's also, you know, sanctioning work, you know, also, you know, is a big thing. You know, within work, work is very normative, right? Now, a couple things before we go. Again, next week we won't have a broadcast because of the holidays, but you know, we'll be back with a new broadcast after that. As far as the lecture today, we'll probably pick up with just a short discussion on the satisfaction of work, right? Again, you know, one of our motivations when we work isn't merely to make money, but it, you know, something that we've been exploring since the, you know, since the first broadcast is this idea that, you know, there's this abstract kind of need that work satisfies in humans, right? Our need to kind of associate something with our identity, you know, so work provides us with statuses, with worth, with hierarchy inside in society itself. And, you know, it's often comparative and we categorize each other, you know, accordingly to this. So, you know, again, you know, like Thorsten Veblen would say, you know, human behavior is strongly influenced by the instinct of workmanship. So, that's it for today. We'll be back in 2 weeks, or not next week, but the week after, with more sociology of work. Bye-bye.